StrayAllDay.com.
You are now tuned into the show where you learn the discipline to show up day after day to do the work, the confidence to put yourself out there boldly and authentically, and the mental toughness to continue showing up, doing the work, putting yourself out there, even when the success you've expected to achieve is on a, you're on a search mission for it, because you can't find it. You have not achieved that success yet, but you're going to keep going. And also, on top of that, to keep yourself moving and to get yourself moving in case you need it, I'm going to give you the personal initiative. This is the go-getter energy that moves anyone to go and make things happen instead of just merely waiting for things to happen. We put all of this together into one mindset, one method, one philosophy, one book, and one show. It is called Work On Your Game. My name is Dre Baldwin, also known as Dre All Day. Today's topic is how to develop and maintain what we call a can-do attitude, a positive, forward-thinking attitude. Everyone's heard of a can-do attitude, right? We're going to talk today about how to actually develop one if you don't have one right now, and how to maintain one. If maybe you've had one, you want to make sure you keep it. Maybe you had one in the past and you think it may have been slipping a little bit. Maybe you have some people around you who you wish had a can-do attitude, but they haven't been having it recently, and you want to help them out. Then you listen to what I'm going to say here, and you can relate this message to them, or even better, have them listen to it. Even better than that, you and them listen to it all at the same time to have a discussion about it. And choosing people for any group, whoever it is doing the choosing, attitude always matters more than ability. Anyone who's choosing a group, if you're listening to this and you haven't been in a position of choosing people for any type of group, whether that be a business, a volunteer organization, a sports team, anything, if you choose ability over attitude, you may have ended up running into some problems in your program simply because the attitudes didn't gel properly. In sports, you hear teams often talk about chemistry. Any of you read any articles on the front offices of professional sports teams and team sports, they often will talk about, listen, yes, we do want the best players. We want the players with the most talent and the players who can perform this skill and that skill in the actual contests in the games, but we also need players who have skill combined with the right attitude, because a highly skilled individual who does not have the right attitude is the most dangerous person you could have on your team. A person with no skills and a bad attitude, you can just get rid of them. They don't have any influence over anyone anyway because they don't have any skills. Nobody's watching them, nobody's paying attention to them because they have no skills. But the person with a lot of skill and a bad attitude, that person can become the proverbial, as they say in sports, the cancer in a team that can destroy everything from the inside out. That can happen in business, it can happen in sports, it can happen in a family even, when you have a person with a lot of ability, because a person with a lot of ability will have influence in that room amongst the team, because everybody on the team knows who has game, they know who can play, who can't play, who has the power as far as what they can do performance-wise and who doesn't. So the person who has that power, that influence that comes with having skill, they better have a good attitude, because whatever their attitude is, the highest skilled individuals in any group, their attitude will permeate through the rest of the group. Everyone else is going to be following their lead, whether you want them to or not. So that's why it's very important that the best people that you have on a team, or whoever becomes the leaders of a team, especially if you're naming people as leaders, but often we end up appointing our own leaders in any group, regardless of who has the title. They better have the right attitude. They better have a can-do attitude, because if they don't, if they have a can't-do attitude, then the whole rest of the team is going to have the exact same attitude. A person with zero skill and great attitude, at the same time, on the other side of things, they have the potential to learn and they are coachable. I can have no skill whatsoever, but if I'm coachable, if I'm open, if I have a can-do attitude, I have the mindset of I can learn this, I can find a way to contribute, whatever you're going to show me, I'm going to take to it and I'm going to do it the way that you want it done. That kind of attitude, that's fertile soil, let's say. That soil is fertile enough that you can plant something there and it's possible that a plant could grow. But if you try to plant your seeds in the mindset of a person who has a bad attitude, those seeds are gonna die immediately. It's like trying to plant a seed in concrete. It's just not gonna happen. So you can work with a person who has the coachability, the can-do attitude. And I'm assuming that you wanna be a person that people see potential in and will want to have around. If you're in a position of, and I think we all maybe vacillate at times in life between doing the choosing and getting chosen, but if you're in a position where you want people to value your presence in any group, any team, then the attitude, is the key to actually doing that. And that's what we're talking about here today. Again, the topic is how to develop and maintain a can-do attitude in life. Let's go right into it. Point number one, first thing is to stay open to learning. Your mind has to be open to understanding that you don't know everything yet, and there is something that you could be taught that you don't possibly know, that you can accept from whomever or whatever is teaching you, and then you'll follow what you've been taught. That's what staying open to learning means. A can-do attitude most often comes in play in life when we are challenged with something that you are not sure that you can do, right? Because you don't really need to think that much about your can-do spirit if you're doing something that you already know you can do. If you're doing something that you've done 100 times before, there's not really, you don't even have to think about, do you have a can-do attitude? You already know you can do it because you've done it so many times already. It's not even a challenge. It's not even something you think about. You just do it unconsciously. You didn't think about today when you tied your shoes, you weren't thinking, hey, can I possibly do this? Can I survive this challenge? You didn't have to remind yourself to have a can-do attitude about doing it because you've done it thousands of times already in your life. The challenge for us, the smarter we get, the more experienced we become, the more you know, the more you can do. And also at the same time, the more you know, often with some people, the less open they become, because they begin to think that they know everything there is to know, or you begin to think that since you know so much, especially relative to other people, you may look at somebody else and assume that they don't know as much as you, or they can't possibly teach you because you know what you know, and you assume for whatever reason that they don't know much they could possibly teach you. So you're not open to hearing it maybe from that particular person. Maybe you're not open to hearing something on a particular subject. Maybe you're not open to hearing something given to you in a certain way. All of those can be blocks. They can be mental blocks to you learning by virtue of you being so smart, by the fact that you know so much. At the same time, as if you are able to do what I'm telling you here in point number one, is stay open to learning, the more things that you learn, if you're constantly doing it, the more abilities that you'll have. I mean, the more things you understand, the more things you could possibly do. And as I've always said, you don't really know something until you've done it, but you have to have the information, at least some information, at least some percentage of the information to get started and do something. You have to have some idea where the hell you're going, what the hell you're doing, what you're trying to accomplish. The more things that you learn, the more options you give yourself for doing things. The more things you do, the more things you'll actually know. And the more open to learning you are as a person, the more things you will be willing to engage with. The more things, the more ideas, the more places, the more people, the more activities, the more habits. You'll be willing to engage with more stuff, the more open you stay to learning, because to learn something means you're going to be engaging with something new, right? So those go hand in hand. You're engaging with something new, you're learning. And if you're learning, you're engaging with something new. All right, so those work together. You can't separate those two. Even when you're engaging with something that is foreign to you, you've never done it, you never thought about it, it's something that, you know, maybe you were taught didn't matter, something that you never even considered, never occurred to you at all. But as long as you're open to it, you have the ability to, first of all, gain some activity knowledge, ability to gain some experience, which will probably lead to some stories that you can share. It increases your personal value. You're willing to engage with that thing. You're open to learning. Now you can add to your skill set. You can add to the richness of who you are as a person, because you have another experience, another skill, more things that you've engaged with, and you keep your mind open to learning. The person who is closed off to learning, the person who consciously or unconsciously believes they know everything that they need to know, this person is not going to approach a foreign situation. That's something that they've never been involved in. That is, they're not going to approach that with a positive mindset. They may not approach it at all. They may refuse to approach it simply because it looks like something other than what they're used to. It looks like something that they're not familiar with, something that they never heard of, something that they've never done. And thusly, because they think they know so much, something that they don't think they need, something that they don't think they really need to hear about. I don't need to know nothing about that. I already know everything that I need to know about this area, or everything that I need to know in this space right here. Why do I need to learn anything new? Why do I need to hear anything else? Why do I need to talk to you about this thing? Why do I need to listen to you? Why do I need to read this book? Why do I need to listen to this podcast? Why do I need to take this course? A person who thinks they know everything they need to know is not going to be open to learning. They will not engage with anything new. You present them with a foreign situation, they're going to push away from it, not because they can't do it, but because their mind is already closed off. So the mind is open. The more open you can keep your mind, the more things you can learn, and the more new experiences you can get under your belt. And this is all under the umbrella of having a can-do attitude. You can't do anything if you're not open to some new possibilities. That's the point that I'm making here. Point number two, today's topic is how to develop and maintain a can-do attitude in life. Number two, always ask yourself, how can I deliver value? That's a question that you should keep in mind anywhere that you are, whatever it is that you're doing. Even if you are highly accomplished and you have a ton of experience under your belt in a certain space, and even more importantly, if you are not accomplished at all, you've accomplished very little or nothing in a certain space or amongst a certain group relative to everyone else, you haven't done much, nobody knows who you are, you have no resume in a space. If you walk in there with the mindset of, man, I've done nothing, I have nothing to offer, I'm not comparable to anybody else in this room at the bottom of the totem pole, if you have that mindset and your mindset is closed to being able to figure a way out to deliver something, you won't be around for too long. A person with a bad attitude and no ability, all right, they don't stick around. All right, they don't even become part of the group in the first place to even need to be kicked out. But if you walk into a place believing that you know nothing, that you've done nothing, that you've accomplished nothing, that you're brand new and you got to earn everything, and at the same time you have a mindset of, I'm going to figure out a way to make myself useful in this group, I'm going to figure out a way to make myself valuable to other people here, that question challenges you to find a way to actually do it. When you say, how can I deliver value? Now you've given your mind a job, because how is an open-ended question. You have to figure out an answer to it. It's not a closed question. It's like a yes or no, black or white, today or tomorrow. How is wide open. You got to figure out how you're going to answer that. Even if the answer to you is not immediately apparent, if you're asking the question, then you have a can-do attitude, because you're prompting your mind to figure out the answer to that question. And if you don't have a can-do attitude, you would never even think of asking yourself that. Can-do thinkers are always looking for a way to find a way. So even if you don't have a way right now, the person with the can-do mindset, okay, I don't know what I can do right now, but I'm going to keep thinking about this. I'm going to keep working on this. I'm going to keep looking. I'm going to figure something out eventually. I remember watching a TV show, The Wire. Any of you ever watched a TV show where they're in one season of The Wire, before I get to the rest of it, or a couple seasons, it was kind of interspersed throughout the show. They will follow these detectives who would go looking for, trying to solve murders. And I don't know anything about being a detective, but any of you ever watched that show, The Wire, or any show where detectives or homicide cops are going around doing their thing, sometimes they get cold on a case. The case becomes cold in that they don't have any new leads. They can't quite figure out who did what. They don't have the right information to solve the case, and they kind of hit a brick wall. But the best detectives always keep looking. They always ask themselves, maybe not necessarily in so many words, how can I deliver value? But they're always asking themselves, what's another angle that I can approach on this case right here? What's another way that I can look at this? What's another way that I could possibly interpret the evidence that I do have so I can figure out what's going on here? And a good detective, they'll continually ask themselves that question over and over and over again, because if they're pretty sure that somebody got murdered, that means somebody did it. It happened somewhere. Somebody is responsible somehow. And as long as they keep asking the question, knowing that there's an answer, there has to be an answer, as long as they're sure that it was a homicide based on what the coroner's examination says, they eventually figure it out. Now, I know on TV, they always eventually figure it out. But in life, it probably works the same way. Again, I don't know if I have any detectives who listen to this or anyone who knows one. You can ask them and they'll probably tell you the same thing. The can-do person is the person that employers, or anyone who's in position of choosing people, they are often encouraged to hire for attitude and train for ability. Why? Because the can-do person is always following point number one, which I just told you, which is staying open to learning, and they're following point number two. They're always asking, how can I deliver value? So while they're learning, they're looking for a way to give something to the group, looking for a way to make themselves viable, to pay for the space that they're taking up. And the person who is open to learning and looking to deliver value in any way possible, all right, that's the person with the right attitude. Now, if they have a little bit of ability, perfect. If they got a lot of ability, you might have a star on your hands. If they have no ability, you still got a chance, as long as they had the right attitude. So any of you who's ever in a position of choosing people, the advice that I would give you is the same advice that I just laid out there. Hire for attitude. Find people who have the right attitude, and then you can teach them the skill. Now, they may need to have a baseline level of skill depending on what you're choosing them for. I mean, if you have a basketball team, you need some people who can actually dribble and make a layup. but finding people with the right attitudes, because the wrong attitudes, those can destroy your whole organization from the inside out. And again, the better they are, the worse they can destroy you. Point number three, today's topic is how to develop and maintain a can-do attitude in life. Keep in mind at all times that you will figure things out. Just like I just explained to you, the detectives, the best detectives out there, even when they hit a brick wall in a case, or they think they have a lead, and they think they're about to figure things out, and they realize that they got it wrong, they realize that there's nothing they can get to with that, maybe they gotta leave a case alone for 6 months and come back to it because they haven't been able to figure anything out, they don't have any new information, they always keep in mind that they will eventually figure it out. They always know that in the long run, they are going to get the outcome that they wanna get. And this is half the battle in life, people. The expectation that things will turn out how you want them to turn out. If you expect things to go not the way you want them to go, expect things to go against you, usually things go against you. When you expect things to work in your favor, usually things work in your favor. Expectations, if you want to know what the rest of your life's going to look like, just look at your expectations. In the long run of life, we all get our expectations. You may not get your expectations in the short run. So if you expect to, you know, get a big windfall of cash in your bank account, it might not happen tomorrow just because you're expecting it today. But if you continue to hold that expectation in your mind over an extended period of time, and that expectation is strong enough and you actually believe it, then it will eventually happen. And it's not because you're just sitting there thinking it and you'll just imagine the money and eventually it just shows up in your account. That's not why it works. It works because when you really expect something, you will take actions that match the expectation. I'll give you a simple example. If someone tells you, you watch on the news, or someone you trust tells you, hey, I know you walk to work every day and you walk home every day, it's probably gonna rain this afternoon or rain this morning, and you agree with them and you expect it to rain, what are you gonna do differently that day? You will probably maybe grab a jacket, you'll probably bring an umbrella, or maybe you'll drive, or maybe you'll take an Uber, something to avoid getting yourself soaked in rain, right? You will take some different action. Why? Because you truly expect something different to take place. So in your life, having an expectation does not just mean thinking about it and writing it down and talking about it. Having an expectation means you will take actions that match that expectation. I told this story probably a couple of years ago here on this podcast. I remember back in the mid-90s, records was a little bit before my time. I mean, they were around. I think I had a couple when I was really young, maybe like late 80s. But then for the most part, we had cassette tapes. If you wanted to listen to music, you got the cassette tape, and that's how you listen to albums. You had to rewind and fast forward just to get to the songs that you wanted to hear, and you had to kind of time it right because there was no way of knowing when you were on song two or song three, so you had to keep finding it, stop it, listen to it, fast forward a little bit, oh, went too far, I got to rewind a little bit. That's how we used to listen to music. And I remember in the Christmas of 1996, I'd asked my parents to get me a CD player. And it was like a three-disc CD changer. And this was like revolutionary at the time. I know I wasn't the first one to have one, but for me, it was gonna be revolutionary because I could put three CDs into the machine, and then with the remote control, I could choose which CD I wanted to listen to. CD number one, number two, number three. So I wasn't stuck with the cassette tape anymore, where I could only listen to that one album, then I had to take that one out, put a different one in, and listen to something. With this three-disc changer, this is something I was gonna have in my bedroom at home. I could choose between at least three albums at the exact same time. With the remote control, I wouldn't even have to get off of my seat in order to change the music. So this is a big thing. Now, before Christmas, I had a little bit of money, and I remember my sister and I had went to the mall, and I went to this music store. I believe it's called FYE, or it might have been Sam Goody, back when they used to have music stores. I go to the mall nowadays, I don't think music stores exist anymore since everything's online and streaming. But I went to the music store and I bought a CD like a week before Christmas. And my sister saw that I bought the CD. My sister's a year older than me, and she was like, why are you buying a CD? You don't even have a CD player. And I said, well, I'm thinking that I'm going to get a CD player for Christmas, so that's why I'm buying a CD. So I'll wait until next week, Christmas Day, and hopefully I'm getting that CD player so I have a CD to play once I get it. I didn't want to get a CD player and not have any CDs, so I can at least have one CD to play once I get my CD player. And my sister went and told my mom. My mom just smiled in a knowing way and said, well, maybe he thinks he's getting a CD player for Christmas. So I wonder how she would have responded if they hadn't bought me a CD player for Christmas. That would have been an interesting story too. But lo and behold, Christmas Day, I did get a CD player. So I had at least one CD to use in my three-disc CD changer in Christmas in 1996. And I'm telling you all of that to drive home my point here. When you expect something to happen, you will take actions around that expectation. And listen, sometimes you might be wrong. You might buy yourself, metaphorically speaking, a CD and don't get your CD player. You might carry an umbrella to work and it doesn't rain. But if you really believe in something to happen, if you really have that expectation, you need to take actions around it. You may need to make an investment around it. And sometimes that investment may be a lot bigger than a $15 CD or, you know, feeling dumb because you're carrying an umbrella and it's bright and sunny outside. All right, it might be a little bit more of an investment you need to make based on your expectation, but if you're not willing to make that investment, the people who are willing to make the investment, when the expectation does come to fruition, they're gonna be ones who get the reward. So are you willing to wager the possibility of maybe looking a little bit silly because you took some actions around an expectation that doesn't happen in order to win the bet, so to speak, of it actually happening and you being ready for it? Or you wanna play it safe. I wanna make sure that I don't look dumb, so I'm not gonna carry an umbrella just in case it doesn't rain. But then if it does rain now, you're the dumb one coming home soaked. Now, which one do you wanna be? In the long run of life, you always get your expectations. Now, to close home this point, let me read you a tweet that was tweeted by a certain person. I'll tell you about it in November of 2009. I'll give you a hint as to who tweeted this tweet. All right, I'll tell you first of all, before I even read it, that it was written by an NBA basketball player. They were playing in the NBA then, they're still playing in the NBA now, at least as of this recording, they're playing in the NBA. Hopefully they don't retire between now and when this comes out. Now at this time, this certain player was a young player, relatively new to the NBA, and his team, oh, let me read the tweet first, then I'll tell you what happened with his team. And then I want you to try to figure out who said this. So this is what the person said. He said, "Promise to all the fans of our team." And this is a quote. All right, so let me start over. Quote, "Promise to all the fans of our team, we will figure this thing out. If it's the last thing we do, we will figure it out." Now I'm gonna tell you again that this player was a relatively newer player to the NBA at this time, 2009. His team, that season when he posted this tweet, they would go on to win 26 games out of 82. So they won 26 and they lost 56. 26 and 56 was their record. And if you don't follow basketball, that's not a very good record. All right, this team was not very competitive. Didn't look like they were going too far. But that's what he said. Promise to all fans, we will figure this out. It's the last thing we do, we will figure it out. Now, what do you think about that? What do you think about a player saying that when his team is winning one game for every two games that they lose? They're not in the playoffs. They're not going that far. This player wasn't this player was good, but they weren't quite tearing the league up at this point. What do you think of that player? You think this player is kind of delusional? You think they're just talking a lot of shit that they can't back up because obviously the team is terrible? You could say all those things. I mean, at that time, you could say that was pretty accurate. I mean, but nowadays, every now and then this tweet resurfaces from this particular player, because I'll tell you right now who it is. It was 10 years ago. This tweet was posted by Golden State Warriors player by the name of Stephen Curry. This is his rookie year in the NBA. He said, "We will figure this thing out. That's the last thing we do, we'll figure it out." And I think Steph Curry and company figured it out. Over the next 10 years, Steph Curry won a couple MVP awards, made a whole lot of three-pointers, won a couple of championship awards. Why? Because he had an expectation that they were going to figure it out. Now, is it possible that the Warriors wouldn't have figured it out and they would have kept losing? Sure. Is it possible that Steph Curry would have never become a star despite the fact that he posted this tweet? Sure. Is it possible, had those things happened, that people would have ridiculed Steph Curry? Like, "Man, you bum. You said y'all were going to figure it out. Y'all never figured it out. You never became a star. Why were you saying that stuff? You never even did it." Is it possible that could have happened? Of course it was. But had Steph Curry not had the expectation that they would figure it out, they probably would not have figured it out, because, I mean, Steph Curry is the centerpiece guy who was around the whole time, from the time he said that to right now, at least as of this recording, he's the only one who's been around. He's been the constant. He knew they would figure it out. They figured it out. Now, again, was he wagering? Could he have possibly been wrong? Absolutely. Would he have been ridiculed for it? Probably. But if he ends up right, now he's like a psychic. He predicted the future and then he went and made it happen. Let's recap today's topic, which is how to develop and maintain a can-do attitude in life. When you're choosing people for any group, remember that attitude matters more than ability. Ability does matter, but attitude matters more. A person with a lot of skill and a bad attitude can become a cancer to your group, so you better be very careful about choosing people who have the attitude I'm describing today. Number one, people who stay open to learning. A can-do attitude comes into play most of the time when we're challenged, all right? Not when we're doing something we know we can do, because we don't need a can-do attitude. You already know you can do it. You already have it. It's already built in. You got to remind yourself of your can-do attitude when you're challenged with something you're not sure you can do. And you got to stay open to learning for this. Point number two, always ask yourself, how can I deliver value? This question challenges you to find a way to make yourself and your group useful, even when the answer is not immediately apparent. This is why employers say hire for attitude and train for ability. At least the smart ones do, because a can-do person is following these first two points. They're open to learning and they're looking to deliver value in any way possible, even when they don't have a lot of skill. Point number three, know that you will eventually figure things out. This is half the battle in the long run of life, the expectation that things will turn out how you want them to. When your expectations are high, your achievement usually ends up high, again, in the long run, because your actions will match your expectations, not just because you're thinking about it. Stephen Curry told his Warriors fans, we will figure this thing out, because the last thing we'll do, we'll figure it out. In the middle of a season when they were going 26-56, nobody saw what was going to happen over the next 10 years, but Steph Curry saw it. He said it, then he went out and did it. Work on your game. Dre, all